The strange quantum phenomenon called tunneling isn't just something physicists think about in their free time. It's happening right now all around us, from the fiery interior of stars to the tiny cells in our body and even in the device you are using to watch this video. This video tells the story of quantum tunneling through experiments and simulations while following the early history of its development without delving into complex mathematical details. Let's begin by doing a simple experiment that demonstrates tunneling of light waves. We will use two acrylic blocks, a prism and a plano convex lens, a laser pointer and a small vise. For light traveling from a medium of higher refractive index like acrylic to a medium of lower refractive index like air, there is a specific angle of incidence called the critical angle, beyond which it experiences total internal reflection. The critical angle for total internal reflection for acrylic-air interface is about 42 degrees. Therefore, as expected in this case, the light incident at more than the critical angle cannot pass into air from the prism and instead is totally reflected. The air essentially acts as a barrier or a wall for the propagation of light under these conditions. But here comes the surprising part. When you introduce the acrylic lens close to the prism, something special occurs. Initially, with a large gap between them, light behaves as usual. However, as you slowly squeeze the blocks together using the vise, bringing the gap down to the order of light's wavelength, a transmitted beam appears in the second medium, defying the air barrier. The intensity of this transmitted beam changes depending on the gap's width. By holding the medium squeezed together and scanning the interface with the laser, we can see that the transmitted light gets weaker as the width of the air gap increases. Technically speaking, the wave amplitude along the surface normal in the barrier medium is exponentially decaying rather than being oscillatory. If a second medium is within the range of this exponentially decaying evanescent wave, it gives rise to oscillating wave in that medium. This phenomenon, called as frustrated total internal reflection, was one of the first hints that waves, like light, can sometimes pass or tunnel through seemingly impenetrable barriers. It was known at least from the times of Newton and Fresnel. With the discovery of the new quantum theory in the 1920s, tunneling of wave began to appear to be relevant for material particles also. The groundwork was laid by Planck and Einstein, who established the concept of light quanta or photons with momentum inversely proportional to the wavelength. Inspired by this, Louis de Broglie hypothesized in 1923 that material particles also exhibit wave-like properties, and the wavelength inversely proportional to the momentum, just like the photons. However, the full implications of this wave-particle duality awaited further developments. In 1926, Erwin Schrödinger unveiled a groundbreaking 3D wave equation that described the behavior of matter waves. This equation allowed scientists to calculate a particle's wave function, a mathematical entity that encodes the quantum state of the system. Shortly after, Max Born provided the crucial interpretation that the squared modulus of the wave function represents the probability density of finding the particle at a specific location. Consequently, integrating this probability density across all space should yield a value of 1. This is called normalization. The wave function can be separated into time and space dependent parts if the potential does not depend on time, yielding what is known as the time-independent Schrödinger equation. The solutions of the time-independent Schrödinger equation, coupled to the time-dependent phase factors, are known as the stationary states, eigenstates, or states of definite energy. The stationary states are the separable solutions of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. but not all solutions of the time-dependent Schrödinger equation are stationary states. Let us take the example of a free particle, which will be useful for later discussion of tunneling. Free from external forces, its potential energy is zero. Solving the one-dimensional, time-independent Schrödinger equation for this particle reveals a sinusoidal solution. When combined with the time-dependent part, it yields plane waves, the free particle stationary states. However, normalizing these infinite plane waves leads to a divergent integral. This implies that free particles cannot exist in these stationary states, meaning they can't have a fixed energy. The solution? We can combine multiple plane waves with weighted amplitudes to create a wave localized in space, making it normalizable. Superposition guarantees this localized wave remains a solution to the Schrödinger equation. This localized entity, called a wave packet, is how quantum mechanics represents free particles. Although Friedrich Hund was the first to carry out formal analysis of tunneling, it was Lothar Nordheim's work using rectangular potential barriers that went on to become textbook examples of quantum tunneling. In 1927, in his attempt to study the emission of electrons from metals, he solved the 1D Schrödinger equation for a steep or square potential barrier, a model for the surface barrier that confines electrons within a metal. The potential inside the metal is Vm, at the surface is Vs, and outside the metal is Vo. Let us consider the scenario where the electron energy in metal is less than the barrier height but more than that outside. Within the metal, electron energy is more than the potential energy and momentum is real. So, the wave equation admits oscillatory or plane wave solutions, which have two components, one moving towards the barrier and other away from it. The wave moving towards the barrier is the incident wave. The wave moving away from it is the reflected wave from the barrier. In the surface, as the energy is less than the potential, momentum is imaginary and the solution is a combination of exponentially growing and decaying parts. Again, looking at regions outside the metal, we realize that the electron energy allows for plane wave solutions like that inside, but only moving to the right as there are nothing there to reflect the wave. The three solutions of the Schrödinger equation and their first derivatives must be continuous across the boundaries between the regions. Applying these boundary conditions reveals a surprising result. The amplitude of the right moving wave outside the metal is non-zero. Therefore, as a consequence of the wave nature of electrons, there is a finite probability of them penetrating and passing through the barrier, despite not having sufficient energy to overcome it classically. This is known as quantum mechanical tunneling, a phenomenon analogous to frustrated total internal reflection in optics. The wider the barrier, the lower is the amplitude of the transmitted wave and hence the probability of transmission, exactly as we have seen with the light waves. However, it is important here to keep in mind that tunneling does not imply that the particle is splitting into two. Rather, it says the probability of finding the particle on the other side of the barrier is finite. A young George Gamow, just 24 years old, arrived at the University of Göttingen for a summer program in 1928. On his very first day at the university library, he stumbled upon Ernest Rutherford's 1927 article in the philosophical magazine about the puzzle surrounding Hans Geiger's 1921 experiments on scattering of alpha particles from uranium-238 nucleus. Rutherford faced a serious dilemma. Scattering experiments with alpha particles confirmed a strong repulsive Coulomb potential in the uranium nucleus exceeding 8.57 MeV in height. Yet, in a process known as alpha decay, uranium-238 emits alpha particles with less than half that energy. How could this be? The fact that the alpha particles remain in the uranium nucleus for long enough time indicates that Coulomb repulsion turns into an attraction at some distance within the nucleus. Thus, there is a potential barrier which, according to classical mechanics, should prevent the internal alpha particles from escaping from the nucleus. Rutherford could not reconcile this paradox, but for Gamow, the answer was in the newly emerging field of quantum mechanics. He recognized it as a case of matter wave penetration or quantum tunneling through the potential barrier. Returning to his room from the library, Gamow devised a simple formula to calculate the probability of this escape, and it matched perfectly with experimental data. Gamow's explanation of alpha decay via quantum tunneling was a major success of the quantum theory and a testament to its power in solving seemingly insurmountable problems. The nuclear fission that powers the Sun is a shining example of quantum tunneling. Classically, the Sun's core temperature is not high enough for nuclei to overcome the Coulomb repulsion between them and fuse. However, their web-like nature allows them to tunnel through this repulsive barrier, enabling fusion with a burst of energy. This tunneling-aided fusion reactions not only power stars, but also creates the heavier elements essential for life. Your smartphones or computers' SSD storage too utilizes electron tunneling. Electrons can tunnel across an oxide barrier within transistors to store data. Tunneling of protons and electrons is surprisingly common in life's fundamental processes as well. It influences DNA mutation, photosynthesis, and enzyme activity, all of which are crucial for the existence of life. In essence, quantum tunneling is a fundamental process shaping our world, from the stars that provide energy to the very processes that sustain life.